Hey everyone, I'm Evan from Evan's Workshop. I'm excited to be here this morning. We're going to give everybody a few minutes to join. Let us know where you're joining us from. If you have any questions while I'm building, please ask your questions in the chat, and I'll try to get to them at the end. I want to thank all viewers from YouTube, Facebook, and Twitch. I also want to thank Lee Valley Tools for having me here today. This morning, I'll show you how to build a magnetic key holder. So let's see where everybody's joining from. Rob from Concept 13. Hi, Rob. Wendy. Hi. Okay, I think we're gonna get started here. So first, I'm just going to tell everybody what materials and tools you need to make this project. Obviously, you can, if you don't have one tool, you can transfer it out for another one. But, I'm going to explain. So we're going to need some wood. So in my case, I have milled up 3 pieces of wood. You can use, one piece of wood instead of gluing one together. It really is up to you. I'm using cherry, walnut, and a piece of maple. Some rare earth magnets. 3 of them. I have 4 just in case one of them goes missing. These are very, very, very strong magnets, which is why I have them taped to a block. We're going to need a Forstner bit, 1 inch, just for the magnets so we can recess them inside the wood. We're going to need a 1/16th of an inch drill bit, a 1/8th of an inch drill bit, some Gorilla Glue, Type-On 3, Clapham's beeswax finish, sawtooth hangers. I've got them all right here. So sawtooth hangers and number 1 pins, and then the mounting nails. So the tools you're going to need are a miter saw or any saw you can use to cut the blank to size once it's all glued up. Yeah, a drill press like this. A drill. That's for the 1/16th inch drill bit and the 1/8th drill bit. Some clamps. A pencil or a pen. I'm using both because along the process, I use both for different reasons. A tape measure, just like this, just so you can mark it out to the right size. Obviously, you can make this blank bigger or smaller. Doesn't have to be this exact size. A square, I've got my squares in here. And then a block plane, and that really does it for all the tools. Okay. So we're gonna get started with the actual building. So before the live, I milled up a few pieces of wood for the actual key holder. Now, obviously you can use 1 piece of wood, in my case I'm using 3, or you can even use a whole bunch, even more than 3. It's really up to you. And so that does it for the wood. And then so now I'm gonna be gluing up the blanks here. So this I'm gonna be using 3 Bessie Uni clamps. And so before I start, I'm actually going to put painter's tape on the clamps. And this is to make sure the glue doesn't adhere to the clamps, and it makes the life of the clamp last much longer. Boyd from Twitch says hi. Show us how it's done. Yes. I'm excited to do this. So what I do is I just take, I'm gonna open up all the clamps. One thing I like about these parallel clamps is they're much smaller compared to the bigger ones that Bessie makes, and they're perfect for smaller projects like this where you don't need as much clamping force. What I do is I just lay it on here and I'll take the painter's tape and I'll put it right there and then I'll rip it. And then I'll put that right here on the clamp. And this, as I said, just makes sure the glue does not stick to the clamps. And it really just makes the clamps last much longer. Okay, that's right size. This one here. Just putting one more. It really doesn't matter what type of painter's tape, or if anything, you can use any tape you want. I find painter's tape works best because it doesn't stick to the clamp, doesn't leave any of the the stickiness to it. Viewers from Kingston in South Texas, that is pretty neat. So thank you all for joining. So I'm just going to get all the clamps lined up here. So I'm going to put two on the bottom, and I'm going to put one on top just to make sure the clamping pressure is even. And so, babies, what would happen if you put all three clamps on the bottom? You'd be putting a lot of pressure on the bottom, and it would cause the board to warp a little bit. So we're just going to play it safe and put one clamp on top and two on the bottom. Now, I don't think you need any more clamps than just three, because I think that does it. However, if you're making this, longer, then I think you can get away with a few more clamps. So I have marked out the orientation I want. So I just drew a triangle on the boards. So just make sure I line them up the way I want them in the correct orientation. This board here, I'm not going to be flipping over. I'm going to take the maple strip, flip it on edge, and then the walnut strip, flip it on edge. And then I'm going to take my glue here. Yes, I agree with you. The small ones are nice for these smaller projects, but the big Bessie clamps do have a place in my workshop, and I think they're great for gluing up bigger things like a desktop, bigger cutting boards, but I think it's nice to have both. I'm using Type-On 3 here. You can really use any wood glue you want. I find this one's nice because it's got the longer open time, so it's easier to line everything up without having so much stress. Just putting it on edge, not using too much. And then I'm just using my finger here just to spread it along. Just like that. And this wood glue is also, the color is more neutral, so it helps blend if there is any micro gaps. It helps blend them together so they're not as visible, the final piece. Okay. Just wiping it away, then gluing it up, just flipping them on edge. And then what I do, I'm just going to, actually just going to bring it a little bit closer to me. So I'm just lining up the ends here. And then what I do is I put pressure on the actual board here, just to make sure they're flat against the rail of the clamp. And that just makes, it saves time. And the next step, which is planing them, flattening it. So just putting light turns until they're fully tightened. You don't need to use too much pressure here, so you don't have to tighten them all the way. But yeah. And then what I'm actually going to do is before I put the third clamp on, I'm just going to take some paper towel here. I'm just going to wipe away any of the excess. And then obviously I think some more will come up once I put the third one on, so I'll just wipe it off again. Because when the third clamp's on, it'll be a little bit more difficult to wipe away all the glue from the top. Take one more. And I think this pattern of the cherry, the maple, the cherry, walnut, and the maple, I think it looks pretty nice. Now you can get fancy by using some nice exotic woods. And yeah. So now I've wiped away everything from the top. Now I'm just going to put this clamp more, not in the center, more on edge like this. It just spreads out the clamping pressure, so it's a little bit, it gets more clamping. Then same thing, just wiping away any more glue squeeze out. And then I'm going to be flipping it over and getting rid of that glue squeeze out. Just taking one more piece of paper towel. Wiping off, trying to get in where the tape is best as possible, and then flipping it back over. And then with this glue, I would leave it overnight to fully dry, but you can get away with leaving it in the clamps for just a few hours. But I'm just gonna set this off to the side, so this is all fully clamped up now. Looks nice. Just gonna be putting this on the ground here. And then what I've actually done, well, I'm just gonna wipe away some of the glue from the bench. So that's gonna interrupt with the next steps. There we go. Just putting those off to the side. So I've actually glued up a separate blank here, and I've planed it, all flattened it and everything. So I'm gonna be finishing with this. So the next step will be, so after it's all glued up, I take a card scraper and I scrape away all the excess glue that didn't get picked up by the paper towel. And I just do that. And then what I do is I take my hand plane. I use my number 4 because it's a smaller blank here. And I just flatten the bottom. Then I flip it over and I run it through my drum sander. So that way it's all nice and smooth. So I've drum sanded this to 120 grit. And so I'm going to start sanding this with a 120 grit on the sander. So I'm going to start with that. However, before I do that, I'm going to take my pencil here. And I'm going to make a grid pattern on the blank here. And this just makes sure that I sand the whole entire piece evenly. It's going like this. Just like this. Just like that, making a grid pattern with the pencil.
While you're doing that, Evan, we have someone on Twitch, Plain Old Woodworking, is saying that a good trick is to put some wax paper under the glue up so that the drips don't affect the workbench surface. Have you ever done that?
I've never done that, but I know that is going to save your workbench in the long run. So, yes, I think that is a great tip. And I probably, yeah, if you have some wax paper in the shop, I'd probably just put some underneath. Just going to save you some time. Just making the grid pattern again on the bottom. And now this looks like I just scribbled all over it, but it's got a good purpose. So next I'm gonna start put on my safety glasses here and my headphones, and I'm gonna start sanding with a 120 grit. Then after the 120, I'm gonna move on to a 180. And yeah. So now that I have the blank sanded to 120 grit, I'm going to move on to a 180. Now, as you can see, I removed all the grid pencil marks, so I know that this piece is now evenly sanded. Now, I'm not going to be putting the grid back on for 180, as I feel. I usually put the grid on the blank, usually the first grit, just remove any of the marks from the hand plane, the drum sander, the planer, anything you use. So I'm just going to move on to the 180. Now it's important when you're sanding, never to move up grits more than 50%. So I'm using a 120. Technically you could get away with going right to 220, but I find using a 180 in between really makes it much better. Now the sander I'm using is a Festool sander. You can find this one at Lee Valley. It's an amazing sander. Now, obviously, you don't need a nice sander like this. Like, my first sander was a cheaper one from Amazon and worked just fine, but I'm happy with this one. Very happy with it. Yes, I agree with Mary. The pencil grid trick is an amazing trick. I even use that pencil trick when I before I joint a piece of wood, plane it, drum sand it. So I just really want to make sure the whole thing gets sanded. Then same thing, put on my safety gear again, and then sanding the whole blank with 180 grit. Now that I've got it sanded to 180, I'm gonna start drilling the holes. So I'm gonna be drilling the holes for the magnets. So what I've done is I have my 1-inch Forstner bit here, and I've put a piece of painter's tape as like a guide stop, just to make sure I don't drill all the way through the piece. Now I'm gonna be finding the center of where I'm gonna be drilling the holes. So I'm gonna be putting 3 magnets in this. I'm gonna be putting one at 4, 8, and 12 inches on this blank. Now I know my blank's 16 inches, so you can really do it any one you want. So take my tape measure, my pen. I prefer the pen for more like precise layout. So 16, whoop. Should put the lock on. Take the cap off. Now making sure which side you want your front and back to be. So I know this side I want to be the back. So I'm gonna put a mark at 4, 8, and then 12. Then taking my square here, and I'm just marking out the line, just extending it a little bit. I find the pen's also much easier to see on the wood. However, the pencil is easier to sand off. You could even use a ruler here. You really don't need a square, but I find it's much easier. And I know this blank is exactly 4 inches. So I'm gonna take my combination square and I'm just gonna put it at 2. Just like that. I think these combination squares are my favorite type of squares. I find them very easy to use and they've got so many different uses. Always finding new ones. And just like that, on the back, I have my lines marked out. Now, what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to take the scribe. This is something that most combination squares have. It's a little metal pointy thing. And basically, I'm just going to find the center of that mark. I'm just going to give it a light thing. In fact, I'm going to take my little hammer here just to make sure. It'll just help with the alignment of the Forstner bit. Because the Forstner bits have this little point here, it'll reference that so it'll make sure the holes are right on point there. Okay. I got that. I'm just putting this back. Now, I like this set of squares, probably the best one I've ever used. They're really good. I bought these ones at Lee Valley. There's a 12 inch one too. And they're just really versatile tools. I love them. They're great. So now I'm going to put the drill bit in the drill press. If anything, I'm going to move my sander away so I don't trip on the cord. So put the bit in the drill press. Just tightening it by hand. Then taking the actual key and then tightening it. Just tightening each individual hole on the chuck. just ensures it's really tight. Now, you could also set up the depth stop on your drill press. However, I find with mine it's a little fiddly, and I find it's much faster just to use the painter's tape. Putting on my safety gear again, but this time I'm going to be clamping the board down to the table just so it doesn't move. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to line up the little point with the hole, and I'm just going to clamp this in. Okay, and then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna consistently check when the painter's tape is right on the surface, as I don't want to go too far in because I don't want the point of the drill bit to puncture the surface. Take your time here and go slow because this is pretty important. Just lining it up, shift it a little bit. So I have one of the holes drilled now. And a sharp Forstner bit really makes this process really fast because it makes a nice clean hole for the magnet. Carmen is tuning in. She's excited to be here. You're doing a great job. Thank you, Carmen. So the Forstner bit is a great drill bit compared to a normal twist drill bit like those ones, as it has these little things on the side and these cutters. So it's basically like a chisel that's like shaving the wood down as it spins, and they're much more accurate than a normal, like a hole saw, twist drill bit. I find them very versatile, and they're honestly my favorite type of drill bits. So I can drill the other two holes now. Just drilling the third hole now. Then it's important after the drill press step to clean up because it's a little bit messy. So now that I have all three of the holes drilled on this piece, you can see here, holes are all drilled. I'm just going to go over the back with the sander again with the 180 grit, just to remove any of the pen lines. When sanding, to make sure you constantly move the sander, as you don't want to make one spot low, you don't want to make a dip in it. So now that I got all three holes drilled on the back and the back sand to 180, I'm actually going to, on the front, I'm going to be drilling the 1/8 of an inch hole for the J hooks like this. Now I find the magnets are great for like 1, 2, 3 keys, but the hooks are great if you have a whole bunch of keys like this, for like a whole bunch of them. And also one thing I find pretty neat is, like, let's say you have a letter to mail, a business card or something you just need to remember, you can just hook it right up there. It won't move. Okay, so I'm gonna mark at 2 inches, 6 inches, 10 inches, and 14 inches. 2 inches, 6 inches, 10 inches, 14 inches. And then same thing like last time, I'm gonna be making the lines. Now you can put the J-hooks up, down, wherever you feel like on the board. I find center is my favorite. You can add as few or as many hooks as you want. I'm adding 4.
While you're doing that, Craig on Facebook is saying that the quick clamps are a really great trick to hold it down while you're drilling.
I agree with you, Craig. Now, one thing in the future, probably, I would like a drill press table, something with a fence that and like a clamp, something that's not as fidgety as like every time clamping it down. But yes, I find the if you don't have a drill press table, the quick clamps work amazing. And same thing, just marking the center. This too. Okay, now that I've got that marked, same thing, I'm using the scribe from the end of the combination square. I'm just finding the center of that mark where the two lines meet. Just like that. And this will help, because these twist drill bits aren't brad point bits, it'll really help the drill bits find the hole. There we go, one more. Just like that. Putting this back. You don't want to lose these because if you step on it, it's probably going to hurt a lot. You know, you can use a drill press or a drill. I find the drill press more accurate, but the hand drill is probably faster. So one eighth of an inch, just like that. Now, if anything, I think I'm going to use the drill press as it's more accurate in this case. Now I'm just going to be removing the Forstner bit, just like that. Just putting that off to the side. And then putting in the brad point bit, not the brad point bit, the one eighth inch twist drill bit. Okay, let's get that. Now I have a piece of painter's tape on here just to make sure I don't go all the way through. However, if you do end up going through a slot, it's not the end of the world because it will just be going through on the back, and the back's not going to be seen. So put that there. Now I'm not going to clamp this on the table as it's just a small drill bit. And not like the big force bit. I'm gonna drill this. Just lining it up here. Okay. It's also very important with the drill press to keep it on the right speed. Now, if anything, I had the speed on a pretty slow speed because I was just using the 1-inch Forstner bit. But that's the thing with the drill. It's much easier, but it's got the variable speed trigger. Now, what I'm going to do is there's a little bit of tear out from the drill. So I'm going to take a 3/4-inch chisel, and I'm just going to just pare away the tear out right there. Just pretty simple. This is an optional step I just find. So it's pretty easy to do, so why not do it? Just like that. Now those are all good. I'm putting the cover back on the chisel. See, they're very sharp. And what I'm going to do again is I'm just going to go over the top with 180 grit, just to remove with these pen lines. It's optional, but I find you could probably just move on to 220, but I find this works pretty well.
Thank you.
Now, one thing I forgot to mention is before drill the holes for the J-hooks, it's important to figure out what size drill bit works best for the particular hooks you're using. Now, what I find works best is I'll take one of the hooks and I'll hold the back, the end of the drill bit, because that has no parts where drills. I'm just going to put it right in front of it. And if I see the thread sticking out, then I know this is a good size drill bit. Don't want to see too much of the thread sticking out, but just want to see a little bit. This just makes sure that the hole, the J-hook will be really snug fit. It'll work really well. Just a neat trick that I use a lot of the time. Okay, I'm going to put this one back in the case. Okay, now next step here is to finish sand it with 220.
Wendy on Facebook saying, I thought the tape on the drill press was to blow away shavings so you could see your work better.
Now, when I actually use the forcer bit, it actually does, when it gets right to the point, it will like shoot the shavings off to the side. So that's another way, you know, it's at the right depth. I'm taking a 220 grit sandpaper here. I'm just gonna sand the whole thing one more time. Okay, putting the pen back there. And same thing, putting on all my safety glasses here. And going over the edges, and I'm gonna round over these edges here as they're quite sharp. So I'm just gonna go over those two. Once the whole thing is sanded to 20, it's gonna start feeling really, really smooth. What I did there was just round over these edges right here, just so they're not so sharp. And then what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take my block plane here. This is a Veritas block plane. It's really nice, really easy to use, and I really, really like it. I'm just gonna take a few swipes at each side here, just making sure that the edges aren't sharp. I usually take an even amount of strokes on each side, just to make sure the bevel is the same. So I took 2, 3, 4, 5. I'm going to take 5 as I feel that's a nice size bevel, not too big, not too small. 1, 2, 3, 4. One more. Now the block plane is probably one of my favorite tools, as I find it very easy to use. 2. Oh, it's squeaking a lot.
While you're doing that, Evan, yep. Mary from Almont says, that handheld sander looks handy.
It is very handy. Now, obviously, you don't need a sander this fancy, but I enjoy using it, so.
Could you do it all by hand?
You could, actually. I feel very possible. And honestly, it'd probably be a very fun hand tool project, and you could probably get the kids involved with it, too, if you're using all hand tools. Like, the block plane's a pretty safe tool to use. 2, 3, 4, 5. Now, properly set up block plane can really tackle any task you throw at it. So there's 5 on that side. And the last one, 1, 2.
And we have someone who just wants you to explain a little bit more why you're choosing 5 strokes and why you're counting as you go
around. I'm using 5 strokes because I want each each bevel on each edge here to be the same. Now you can do one here, two there. I just find I want them all to be the same. And the reason why, also why I took 5 strokes, is I like this size of a bevel. Not too big, not too small, but just makes it so it's not so sharp if you were to touch it. And you can see the little shavings that come off of it are very nice and fluffy. That off to the side. Now that that's all done, I'm going to be gluing in the magnets on the back here. So these magnets are super, super, super strong. So I actually had to take them to the scrap piece of walnut here, just so they wouldn't all come together in the car. So I'm going to peel all the way all the tape. I probably use a little too much tape, but I'd rather be safe than sorry. Right there. Now I brought 4 and I only need 3. One of them's up there. So there's 1. Be very careful not to get them stuck together because they are very, very difficult to take apart.
Do you have any tips for taking them apart or?
What I found works best. So if they're all stacked up, they're all stacked together, I would take like a putty knife and I would basically hold one of them and I'd like pry it apart. I would probably use the plastic one just so the metal one doesn't stick to it. But that's, I mean, there's probably a lot of other ways to do it, but I think that one for me works best.
That's a good tip.
So I actually kind of forgot the Gorilla Glue, so I'm gonna be using the Tight Bond here. So it'll all work fine in the end. You're just gonna have to let this one dry for a little bit longer. So before you hang it up, I'm just gonna use a little bit, not too much. You can always add more, but can't take away. Well, obviously that goes to show you it's live and, you know, nothing's edited. Now, because this is a metal, right? Because it's metal and not another magnet, it doesn't matter which way you put it in. Because if these ones, those are the wrong side. Because like, you know how magnets, like one side sticks together, one side wants them to pull apart. So you don't have to worry about which side you put them in because that's metal and it's not a magnet. So I'm gonna put that in like this. Now it's very tight fit, which is good. And then just taking the pencil, you can also use something like a CA glue with an activator. That would also work just fine in this case. Make sure they're right at the bottom of that hole. Okay, just like that. There's a little bit of glue right there, so I'm just going to wipe that off with my finger. Now that that's on, I'm going to just double check that they're all on the bottom. You can add glue. So if you see here, the glue is only enough to keep it on the bottom, and it's not flowing out of that top hole, so there's not going to be a lot of squeeze out. So next, I'm going to be marking out for the sawtooth hangers. So the way I'm choosing to mount this to the wall, is I'm going to be using these 61mm by 7mm sawtooth hangers. These are available from Lee Valley. They're great. And which way do I open this? Right there. So I'm going to be using 2. I feel 2 is more than enough. You can probably get away, I don't know. I think 2's all you can do. I don't think you can get away with 1. So what I've chosen to do, so I'm taking my combination square again here, and I'm putting it to 1/2 inch. Just locking that in. And I'm using my pen. Now I find 1/2 inch on each side's good distance. So now that I have this one set to 1/2 inch, I'm gonna take this. I'm just gonna trace the edge here. And you don't wanna put too much pressure on the middle here because it will bend. So I'm just using very light pressure, just holding it down enough. So, and then I'm going to be putting the hole, I'm just tracing out the hole there. And I can do, see that over there, how I just traced it, put the hole location. Then doing the same thing on this side here. Just making sure it's at 1/2 inch on each side. And that is same thing, taking my pen, tracing along the outer edge here. You can also use a pencil here. I just find the pen easier to see. tracing out the hole too. Now that I've got those all set up, I'm gonna be using a 1/16th of an inch drill bit and drilling out those holes. Now, be careful not to go all the way through, but because it's a smaller drill bit, you can put it all the way into the chuck and it won't go through. Now I'm using a handheld drill here, as the 1/16th, the chuck on the drill press doesn't go as small as a 1/16th of an inch. So I'm just using this. Now one trick, there's a smaller drill bit. You can put it just like that. Just put the board right up to the side and see, kind of like a little depth stop. Oh, wrong way. That again. Right there. And that way it's, you can see how far you're going. And then just drilling out that hole, just being careful to line it up here. There's one. Being careful just to stay right on the line. I'm starting off slow and speeding up the drill. Like that. Just like that. So now I've got the 1/16th of an inch holes drilled. I'm just going to put the drill bit back so I don't lose it because it's a very small drill bit. Okay, there's that. Okay. And then I'm just going to take the sander again and just sand off those. I'm wearing safety goggles. And just sand off those pen marks. Just like that, I got it all marked out. I'm just gonna put these back in the bag for safekeeping so I don't lose them, even though there's plenty of them. Next, I am going to, so I've drilled out the, so okay, so the next step here is I'm gonna be finishing it. So you can, before you finish it, you can get creative here. You can get something engraved, like I got the words keys laser engraved here. You can get creative, you can use a Cricut machine if you have one and put sort of like design. If you want, you could like paint it, but I'm just gonna finish it as is, and yeah. But you can also put like laser engraved keys after the fact, but I find it a little bit easier to do it before. So yeah, so it's starting to take shape now. Looking nice. Oh, and if anything, just a little spot there that I think I missed with the sander. So now's the time, obviously, to just do the sanding touch-ups, make sure everything's perfect. If anything, what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put some paper towels down, just like that. Just to make sure I don't scuff up the bottom of it when I sand top, wrong side. Okay. So now that I've got the whole thing fully sanded, I've got the holes drilled for the J-hooks, got the magnets put in, got the holes for the sawtooth hangers put in, I'm ready to finish it. So for the finish, you can use any finish you want. I'm using this Clapham's beeswax. They sell it at Lee Valley. Great product. Very easy to apply. I'm using a white Scotch-Brite pad. And what I'm going to do, just kind of fold it, put a little bit on it, just not too much. I'm just going to start like circular motions and just kind of buffing it on just like this. Now you can see the grain starting to really pop. This is probably my favorite part of the whole process. Like this, I'm just gonna go more in the center here. Just gonna put a little bit more on. And one tip is like you can reuse these pads by just when you're done putting in a Ziploc bag, and that way you can just get more life out of the pad instead of cutting a new one every time. Just making sure I got all the spots here. Taking a little bit more, just a touch more.
And we have Paula here on Facebook who's saying that non-slip shelving liner is also great to put underneath when you're sanding because it protects
yes.
the but it also stops it from moving around.
On my personal workbench at home, I have one of those non-slip liners, and they work great. I get mine from dollar store, so they're really cheap, and I can just use it, abuse it, and then I can just replace it for a few bucks. And it really, really helps, obviously, with the vibrations, too, of the sander. And it helps in general for everything. I'm just going to put a little bit more and then do the ends. So if you have any questions, I think now's the best time to ask them, and I'll answer them right now, as this is a pretty chill step of the process. I'm just doing the ends here. Any questions?
We don't have a question, but we have a funny little statement from Plain Old Woodworking, who's saying that most of his power tools are older than they, and then he is at this point.
Yeah.
Boyd Custom Bad is saying that this is a great technique that you're showing.
Thank you.
People asking maybe a little bit about what other ways do you think that they could personalize this?
So you can paint it, you can laser engrave it, you can use a Cricut machine. On the one I have here on the back, I have branding iron and I put my logo on the back. So that's another way to customize it. You can use a stencil. You can even use a CNC machine and engrave a big logo, and you can put epoxy in it and with a color, and I think that would look pretty cool. So there's a lot of things that you can do to make it your own. And I think that's part of really the fun part of woodworking, is you can make something and really make it your own.
Yeah. And then we have Mary Lee Eno on Facebook as well, who's asking, how long does it take for the wax finish to dry? And do you apply two coats or just one?
So for this particular thing, because it's just going on the wall, I'm only going to be putting one. And the thing I like about this finish is once it's buffed on, you can take a paper towel and buff it right off. So that's the nice thing about this finish. Unlike some finishes, you gotta brush it on, let it dry, then you can use it. But I think that's one thing I really like about this stuff, is it's really easy to use. Going in circular motions, making sure to get all of it. Just like that.
While you're working on that, Evan, do you have any projects that you're working on for the holidays as gifts for people?
I'm just wrapping up some charcuterie boards for holiday gifts. I'm probably going to be done next few days, so I'll get a little bit of a break before the winter break. So,
do you want to tell people how they can find you?
So you can find me on Instagram. I have a website. So my Instagram is evans_workshop. And my website is evansworkshop.ca. And yeah, that's all the platforms I have.
Yeah, and I think we're putting them in the chat right now, so if anyone's interested.
Awesome. Another thing to make sure you got the whole thing, especially with these wax finishes, you can hold it right up to the light, and you can, if you didn't get everything, you can see a dry spot. So that's one tip I have. You can check the bottom too. Yep, it's all good. So what I can do is I can take a paper towel, I folded it two times, just like this. I'm actually going to make it that. I'm just going to start buffing it off. So just same thing, circular motions. And then once it starts to get sawdusty, then you can flip it. So there's that. So I'm going to flip it just like this and just do that step one more time. And you can really start to see the grain of the wood. It's really, really nice. Just buffing off the ends here.
While you're finishing that, are there any other projects that you can think of that the rare earth magnets would be good for?
Oh, so actually in the new year, I want to build a plane tail for all my Veritas hand planes. And I want to have them, so they're going to be on an angle. And I'm going to be putting magnets so they can really stay on the plane tail. And then I also want to put a chisel holder with the magnet. So there's a lot of things in the shop and at home, that there's a lot of uses for them. That's why I think they're really cool. Just buffing it off. Okay. And next Friday at 7 p.m., Concept 13 and his daughter Valentina will be making two wooden Christmas decor objects. So tune in for that. It'll be also a Lee Valley Live. So yeah, just putting it out there. Okay, so I've got the whole thing buffed off and it's starting to feel really, really smooth. You can really see the grain pop now, just like that. So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna put the sawtooth hangers on first. So I'm using these number one pins from the Valley and sawtooth hangers. Two of them. I'm using a small hammer, you really don't need much here. Find opening it, it's always the hardest part for some reason. Flip it over. Okay. So I'm just gonna start by putting the little pin in the hole. Each hole. See, because we traced it, they line up perfectly. So what I can do is I can take my little hammer, just lightly tap them in, do each one. Just like that, there's one. See, there's one. Now let's do the second one. If any more questions, please type them in. So, okay, there's that one. Let one more on. And the 1/16 inch drill, it really makes the nail nice and snug, not too loose, so it'll really stay. Okay, and there's the back. Now I'm just going to make sure magnets are still before the glue fully sets. Make sure they're fully at the bottom there, which they are. So I'm going to flip the thing over, put those away. And I'm going to take the J-hooks. Now these ones are, I need to see the exact measurements here. They are 1 1/3 inch. I'm using 4 of them. You can find them on Lee Valley's site. They have a whole bunch of different sizes and different shapes. And I think the U ones work really well for this one. So I'm just gonna start threading it in. What I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take the clamp. I'm going to, I'm actually going to use that to thread it in, as obviously your fingers will start to really hurt by the first one. So I'm just clamping that and just twisting it, just like that. It's a neat trick. You can also use pliers or something, but I like how the clamps have the rubber jaws so they don't damage the metal or anything. Almost there. I need to make sure which side's the top. Okay.
Alexa from Twitch is saying, can't stay, heading to work, but you are a really great presenter.
Thank you, Alexa. I appreciate that. I'm kind of new to all these live stream things, so it's really nice with all that encouragement. Same thing, taking the clamp, put it up like this. And just clamping it in. I think the 6-inch clamp like this works best for this. But if you do have a 12-inch clamp, you get more torque tightening it, so it'll be even easier to do. But just use anything you really have. Okay, there's one. Just making sure they're all straight up and not on an angle, even though that's a very easy fix. And because we use the drill press, all the holes are nice and square, so very easy. So it's all very easy and square. Just almost there. Oh. I can probably go one more. Just like that, yeah. Last one. Almost there. Okay.
Alexa is also, she's jumping off here, is saying that she really appreciates, I'm paraphrasing, but she, my God, the things I wish I had thought of rubber clamp versus fingers.
Yeah. Because I learned that the hard way too. So yeah, it's great here. Okay.
Sorry to interrupt you, Evan. Yep. Also wondering, you said that there's an easy fix if they weren't if they were a little bit crooked? What would the fix be?
Taking the clamp and just screwing it in a little bit more or loosening it a little bit. So it's really easy to do. And starting, look at that. Looking pretty good. Now you could have put this side as a top, that side. But yeah, it's looking, I think that's how you make a key holder. So yeah, so I want to thank. Second.
Oh, before you do that.
Yep. Oh yeah. Last questions. Let's get them in.
Yeah, let's get a couple more. Eileen on Facebook is saying as well, like the clamp trick. I think the clamp trick is the most popular one so far. They've broken a lot of ballpoint pens and pencils trying to twist hooks into the wood.
Yes. Sometimes what you can even do is you can take, if you have an extra hook, you can put it into your drill and drill it in that way. So there's a lot of different ways to do it, but I find the clamp easiest to do is you really have a lot of control over it. I like the drill, like it would really turn that thing in. So yeah.
Yeah. So Robin Lee is jumping in here and saying, really good presentation, Evan.
Thank you. Appreciate that.
Yeah, Robin Lee on Facebook. Thanks, Robin. Any last minute sort of tips and tricks that you'd want to give for this, or things that people want to make sure that they remember?
I mean, painter's tape trick on the drill bit works really well. The clamp trick, the pencil with like drawing the grid before you start sanding, all great tricks. Yeah, that's about it.
Perfect. And anything for people who are thinking maybe that they're going to do some projects, over the holidays, anything you want to recommend to them?
Have fun.
Yeah. Have fun is the key to it, right?
Yeah. So any last questions, let's get them in now before we wrap this up. So yeah.
I think we might be good. Give me one sec. We're going to look on lots of platforms. Those are the questions for now. And if anyone has any questions for you, they know where to find you,
exactly.
Right?
Exactly. You can email me too. So yeah, I want to thank everybody for joining here on YouTube, Twitch, Facebook. I hope you enjoyed this build. I had lots of fun. Thanks again to Lee Valley Tools for having me here today. And don't forget to follow Lee Valley on Facebook, Instagram, YouTube. Yeah, thanks so much for watching. Happy holidays.